Hey, everybody. Very excited to do the Bazel talk here at the DPE Summit. This is the perfect audience to tell about my favorite build system. And also welcome to the last hour of the conference. I hope you all have just enough energy left to get through these talks. My name is Alex. I worked at Google for a long time. Been working basically on Bazel since 2008. I'm unreasonably passionate about making build and test work for developers in large code bases using Bazel. And started this company I'll tell you about at the end, called Aspect. I want to start out this talk by taking us all the way back to the beginning, Bazel 1.0. And this was the blog post. And I've highlighted a little quote here. Users have reported 3x test time reductions and 10x faster build speeds after switching to Bazel. Well, that sounds great. So everybody is sold, right? The keywords here are users have reported. And that's the part I want to talk to you about today. So who are those users? What did they do? How did they make that happen? So last year at the Bazel conference, I think Max maybe is in the room. We heard from Tinder that they had a fantastic reduction in the average CI build and test time when they switched to Bazel. The year before that, we heard from Tencent that they also had great results. The year before that, we heard from Adobe. I got tired of going back through YouTube and finding these screen grabs, so I didn't go to the rest of the Bazel conferences. But really, every year, we get some testimonial from the Bazel community that it is possible to get this promised speed up from using Bazel. So what do we see in practice? So our company has been doing consulting and professional services. We've worked with about over 40 companies now. What we've seen pretty consistently is that the Bazel builds are not that fast. So I'll show you a couple of examples. This is from VideoAmp. Here is a change that was a single line added to a markdown file. Should be fast. Answer, not fast. Okay, I mean, 4 minutes, at least, it's just not acceptable. We're taking a look at another example. Here is Assembly AI. We went and saw a 99th percentile build. So this is sort of, you know, 1 out of 100 is this slow. 20 minutes, not really acceptable. So if I can pause for a moment and do some audience participation, could you raise your hand if you've used Bazel before? Okay, wow, great, okay. Now keep your hand up if you got the promised speed up. Okay, wow, that's better than I could have done if I had faked it. So for the most part, most of you are in this sort of before state. So I hope this talk is relevant. Why are you not getting this promised speed up? We heard from BazelCon speakers that it's possible. Well, it's because they had to do a ton of work to make it possible. And part of the reason they go to the conference is that they're proud of the work that they did and the results that they got. They want to share with the community. But that's just not how Bazel works out of the box. I wrote a blog post that you can find on our blog. It really is like a lot of steps. And that's sort of what I want to spend most of this talk going through. So the first step is probably kind of obvious, which is persistent versus ephemeral runners. So on CI, you know, on the left, sort of in the before state, you run a build tool. And in order to avoid stale results, you want to have an ephemeral runner every time. So there's a new instance of this build runner that comes up. And that's because you don't trust that the build tool will give you the right results. Like it might give you a green build when it should be red because the previous build populated the machine with some stuff that it finds. But Bazel is really designed the opposite way. Bazel is correct. We want to rely on it to be incremental. And in order for it to be fast, we have to reuse the workers. And then also we add a remote cache so that all of these workers can share their intermediate build artifacts with each other. And this is what we have to do to make Bazel fast. This is the first step, I should say, because, you know, are we done? Is this the end of my talk? Well, I have more time, right? So no, it's not. There's a whole laundry list of de-optimizations that will still happen even after you've accomplished this first step of having persistent runners. And I'll list these in 4 sections to try to make this part of the talk, you know, not just go on and on the same slide. So starting off in the analysis phase. So Bazel has a dependency graph. In order to build that graph, it has to analyze all these input files in a really large repository that can take a couple of minutes. And it's easy to accidentally redo that work because it stores the results of the analysis phase in the JVM. Bazel has like a long-running server. If you restart that thing, or if you just change some flags next time you call Bazel and accidentally some of those flags affect analysis, it will just discard the analysis cache and do it all over again. Next, we have low cache hit rates. So I mentioned this remote cache earlier so that all of the workers can share intermediate build artifacts. That needs to be as close to 100% cache hit rate as you can make it for like a change that just introduces a line to a markdown file. Non-determinism is the main reason that you'll end up doing too much work on CI. Non-determinism means for the same inputs, the build produced different outputs, right? And so timestamps or absolute file paths on the machine ended up in the outputs. So then you don't get a cache hit for anything downstream of that. There's various ways that non-determinism creeps into your build. It could be third-party installs, like some, there's like Python did an install and left a path in a file. You could be running tools that just don't have stable sorting. You could be accidentally stamping version control information into your build when you don't mean to. And then finally, the cache might just be replicated in a way that it has a split brain. So you're talking to a cold replica, even though other replicas have a cache hit for this thing already. The third group is mistakes in how you host one machine, one worker machine. So the worker just needs to be optimized in the normal ways that you would do as a DevOps engineer, which is to say, like, avoid spinning disks. You want really fast I/O to the disk, so you definitely don't want network volumes. You can get a speed boost, even more I/O if you can make a RAID zero network out of the available devices. Also, since we're reusing machines, we don't want to slowly leak resources over time. Could be file handles. It could be Docker containers that end up sort of staying resident in the Docker daemon. And then the last group is mistakes in sort of distributed systems land. The first example here is you do a Git checkout at the beginning of your CI step. That is now rebasing you from whatever the previous state of this machine was, and it will invalidate a bunch of the graph. Now the next job comes in and rebases it back again. You might have the either no elasticity, just a fixed pool of these worker machines, or the scale out might be slow to get a new machine. And then once you have a new machine, that machine is cold and it's not going to give you the promised Bazel benefit. You have your whoever's work comes to work first in the morning is going to hit all of these cold machines, and they have to pay the cost every day of like scaling out the system for the rest of the day. So I think it's common wisdom in the Bazel community that remote execution is cool and maybe it solves all of these problems. I like to think of remote execution as the performance optimization of last resort, because it is a way to bring a lot more machines online and have Bazel be backed by a lot of workers that can do all the extra work that you're doing. Why is that not such a great idea? Well, first of all, it's broken in a lot of cases. So you'll have a lot of work to do to deal with things like Bazel rules. This is the plugins for Bazel. When they don't understand the difference between a host platform and the execution platform where these runners are. It also makes you have much stricter hermeticity. There may be things that you rely on the machine that's making your build pass today, but then when you switch to remote execution, those things are not on the disk, and so you have to fix. It's also more expensive, and this is only a problem in the last couple years when our industry has started to care about whether things are expensive. You can paper over doing too much execution by just throwing more machines at it. Well, like, that does make it faster, but at a pretty high expense. And then again, there are problems in the rules ecosystem. So I would call out rules Docker here, which we've mostly replaced at this point. But it has really large input-output files, and so there's a lot of network cost in moving things back and forth. Remote execution can make sense, but there are also alternatives. If you don't want to spend the amount of money required to run everything affected, you can select fewer tests to run. You can have things that are run nightly. There are a lot of trade-offs to make. This paper is great. I was sort of going on my tirade about this on LinkedIn, and somebody pointed me to this paper, which is not about Bazel or even build systems. It's just distributed systems in general. But you can have a second computer when you've shown you know how to use the first one. This paper has just a bunch of gems like that where, I mean, you know, all the authors are unaffiliated because, you know, they're free to say what they think. It's great. I encourage you to go find that paper. All right, so those are the first two sections, right? There's running persistent workers and then avoiding all these de-optimizations. The third thing you're going to have to do is just feature parity. So this is, you know, keeping builds fast is the first step. So there's this concept of a build cop. If you have a mono repo, then if you're using Bazel, you're probably moving towards a mono build, which means that one person can break it for everybody. So you need to keep the main build green. But it might also be that the build is getting slower over time. So you need some way to report this to the right person and close the loop that it's getting repaired. You definitely want to gather metrics. We've heard a lot at this conference about gathering metrics. The relevant ones from your Bazel cluster are things like the cache hit rate, which is in the upper right, very important. You have graphs about different targets and how their behavior is over time to catch regressions. You're going to want to set up stuff like that. So CI is great, but you're also going to want to do continuous delivery. And so how does Bazel play there? Well, Bazel just dumps all the files in the Bazel output tree and has no opinion about what you do with them next. So you have to figure out, for a given commit, what changes caused which applications to need to be delivered again. So like, which things do I need to rebuild? And then rebuild them with the stamping feature turned on. And so there's quite some work to do there. The developer experience, and I'm sorry, this isn't really legible on this screen. Developers are going to see this really long log file from Bazel. That's not what they want. They want to see just the standard output from the tool that failed, or just show me the diff that you're telling me that I need to apply. I think that they don't really want to click away to some other build results UI. They just want to see this stuff right there in the CI or in their code review thread. So that's a great thing for you to build to make developers more productive with Bazel. And if you'll excuse me, I do have one slide in here, which is a product pitch. If you don't feel like staffing a team to do all of those things, all of that is taken care of in a product that we've built, Aspect Workflows, which runs on your cloud, on your CI. You don't need to migrate anything. You don't pay us more money if your build is slower, because there's more work to do like you would if you were paying for remote execution. And we give you a free 1 month trial to prove that it's really fast. And we think in most cases pays for itself. But let's get back to fact. So I claimed that all of those are the de-optimizations. Let me just prove to you that like we did actually see these improvements happen, right? So video amp I mentioned earlier with that no-op build went down 2 minutes. That's great. Every second counts, right? At Assembly AI, we got about a 2x speed up on their 99th percentile builds after fixing all these de-optimizations, hosting Bazel the right way. And then there's a whole case study here. I'll go through it a little quickly, but you know, they had a challenge that they were spending 10 to 30 minutes on CI, and they were spending the equivalent of 2 software engineer salaries on machines to host the CI workload. So we ran our Aspect Workflows trial. We showed them it was a pretty smooth transition for their developers, and the results we got, and I did not doctor these, are exactly the things from the Bazel 1.0 blog post. Their builds went from 11 minutes to 1 minute. There's the 10x speed up we were told we were supposed to expect. Their tests are 2 to 3x faster, and not included in the Bazel 1.0 blog post, they saved money. They had over 67% reduced compute costs, even though they were adding tests to adding workload during the period that we were running this trial, right? So they said, we went from having significant limits in CI and tools to where the limits are now just due to our code. So that's the end of the talk. Thank you very much for listening. I have a couple of calls to action for you. So definitely come and check out our doc site. We have a lot of documentation about Bazel generally, documentation about rule sets, but in particular for this workflows thing, you can actually see what I just described on a bunch of open source repositories and get a sense of how it works. And we also, as I said, we offer a free trial. Come and book a demo with us. I hope that everybody is able to get the promised Bazel speed up. Thank you.